really represents the lords of the four cardinal points: north, south, east, west. That is a good guess, a good theory, especially because the Keck and the Pharang may really stand for the geographical location they come from. Except that if you read the extant documents from the early Bangkok period, you know that the Thais didn't make any big difference between the West as Europe and the West as Persia. This whole part of the world was all considered to be the West. And even when it was placed in the sacred cosmology of the Tripum, these were the lands to the west of Suvarnabhumi. There was no distinction being made. But the other point that I want to make is that once again, there seems to be a link, however unclear, between Buddhasasana, the scriptures to store in the cabinet, and the presence of this Kunhun, the presence of the Pharang and the presence of the Keck. Now, let me explore another very common iconographic motif in the life, in the murals that represent the Tosa Chant. And these are the foreigners that always appear in the scene of the army of Mara, the enemy of the Buddha, who attack the Buddha, try to, they attack the Buddha, and they are always defeated by the Buddha. There are many representations of this kind in many Thai murals all over Thailand. This is interesting from a stylistic point of view. It's from the Thomburi period. You can see, the early Ratanakosin period, that is from Bat Suvarnabhumi in Thomburi. And here you can see Khon Jin, Khon Pharang, and a Khon Keck here, very clearly, another Khon Pharang here. Where does this motif come from? It wasn't invented by the Thai artists. It comes from very far away. It comes from the sculpture of Gandhara from northern India, from the early centuries of the Christian era. This is one of the first school that gave anthropomorphic representation of the Buddha. This was the first artistic school that represented the Buddha as a human being. And this is a scene of the meditating Buddha being attacked from the devils, the evil forces of the army of Mara. You can see that there is an Hanuman, there is even a monkey here carrying a big sword as they try to hurt the Buddha. This is another scene of the another representation of the same scene. This is from Wat Ya Intaram in Chonburi. Rang, Jin, the Keck is here, very, very clearly represented. Again, the army of Mara that attacks the Buddhasasana, and they are going to be defeated. You should imagine that whoever look at these murals knew very well how the story will end. The Buddhasasana will triumph, and the army of Mara, represented here as Kunhun, will be defeated. Now, I want to make a comparison, an historical comparison, with Indonesian, specifically Javanese art, which is interesting. I think one of the challenges that Thailand has had as ASEAN becomes more politically prominent is to try to understand your neighbors a bit better. It seems to me that there is not enough attention being paid in Thai education about your own neighbors. Of course, course you know a lot about Kompama because those are your traditional enemies, right? So you have a lot of bad press that you need to revise. You know a bit, quite a bit about Kongjin because Kongjin is so central to the history of Pathet Thai itself. But you know very little about the rest of the region. You don't know much about Vietnamese. You don't know much about Malays, despite the fact that many Malays live in the south of Thailand. You know very little about Indonesians, who are also Malays. The point I want to make by means of this comparison is that because Thailand was not directly colonized, it didn't develop in the arts a kind of style of painting that was very important in the 19th century, so-called historical paintings. This is a painting done by a Javanese aristocrat called Raden Saleh, and he illustrates the defeat by the Dutch army of Prince Diponegoro, who had tried to oppose the Dutch conquest of Java. It's a very important painting, because it gives us a nationalist version of this story. Yes, Diponegoro is defeated, but the Javanese still support him. He is a kind of proto-nationalist hero to the Javanese. So look at the scene here, as Diponegoro, the defeated Diponegoro, is being sent by the Dutch general. This is the general of the Kok, who defeated Diponegoro, is going to be sent into exile. The coach waiting for Diponegoro is waiting. The Javanese were also supported the rebellion here, paying their last homage to their defeated hero. And his wife is crying and holding on his vest. She's not the only one crying, you see the other one. The Dutch are just, you know, allowing this last farewell to take place before dispatching this enemy of the colonial state out into the far islands. Now, this is not a scene from myth. This is not a scene from Thosa Chat. This is not an image from the Trai Phung. This is a historical event that really took place in Java, before this painting was made, a few years before this painting was made, in the 1830s, to be precise. What kind of point I'm trying to make? That because colonialism didn't exist in Thailand in the same shape, in the same open force that existed in Indonesia, Thai artists didn't have the need to represent their interaction with Farang in historical terms. But this interaction did exist. Farang did trade and made political contacts with with Bangkok, with Ayutthaya before. And so their place here is not in history, but is in something else that maybe we can call religion, or Sasana, or we can call myth. But myth is not just imagination. Myth also exists in the mind of people. Myth can be as real as history. If you think about it, how real some characters from myth can be for people. Even characters from literatures can be very real. I saw on the conference program that there are several papers that deal with literature. Think about Sherlock Holmes, which is a literary figure that was invented all in the 19th century. And you know that Joachim Bajirabu translated into Thai some of the stories of Conan Doyle. Many people treated Sherlock Holmes as a real historical character. You know that for many years people wrote letters to Sherlock Holmes, and they posted these letters before email was invented, when you still have to send a letter by mail, to the address of Sherlock Holmes' imaginary house in lamp. I'm making this example to try to make you appreciate how the army of Mara, even though it did not exist historically, perhaps for the Thai viewers was as dangerous, as much as a threat, as the real Dutch army was for the Javanese. These are also paintings that most of you are familiar with, I'm sure. This is the very famous Kua In Kong, this painter monk who was the favorite artist of, as you know, King Mongkut. And that's why when King Mongkut became a king, he asked Kua In Kong to paint the walls of Vapovonivet, which is where King Mongkut had been an abbot before ascending to the throne. These are very famous murals. First of all, because finally we have a name for the artist, we have a biography of this artist, but also because after a long time, Westerners appear to be dressed in the style of the time. This mural is also from the mid of the 19th century. So it's the same time as the mural by Kua In Kong. But look at the way the Farang and even the Kek are dressed. The Farang is still dressed in the style of Louis XIV, like 150 years earlier, as if fashion has never changed. But the Farang who were going around Krumtap in the middle of the 19th century were not dressed in that style. They were dressed in this style. Why? Why did Kua In Kong finally decide to abandon that iconographic motif of that old style of dress and finally represent the Farang the way they were really dressed at that time? And yet, this Farang, like the one at the beginning, they are still witnessing a Buddhist miracle. They are still in awe and admiration of what Puttasasana can do. So there is a change in iconography, but the message seems still to be the same. The Puttasasana will triumph over Christianity, will triumph over Islam. I give you the other side of the coin, because as the Farang were becoming more and more prominent in Krumtap at the time of King Mongkut, Siamese ambassadors were sent from King Mongkut to England, to France, and even to the Vatican. And you know, I come from Rome, so the Vatican is there. The Vatican is a small city inside the largest city of Rome. Many people think that the Vatican is another place. No, the Vatican is in Rome. Everywhere they went, the Siamese ambassador brought presents with them. And one of the presents was the famous photograph of King Mongkut sitting next to his queen, the mother of King Chulalongkorn. This photograph was sent around as a kind of business card to introduce the face of King Mongkut to these other important emperors at the time. But look at this painting. This is by a French artist called Léon Jérôme, who is very famous for his Orientalist art. Yes, it's true, this is probably the way Siamese ambassador pay homage to a foreign king, as well as to the Thai king. But if you look at the scene with Napoleon III, here, receiving this embassy, what kind of sense do you get? This is not just a photographic representation, photography before photography, so to speak. Art is never objective. Even when it pretends to be objective, it's never so. Even photography, in fact, is never objective. There is always a message underneath. And the message here is very clear. that as the Pope Leo III was trying to make an